So it was just like catching up with a friend.
Yeah.
Totally. Oh, and I like that Abigail is still around.
Oh, when Abigail made her
Abigail
cameo.
Abigail showed up. Oh. I was like, there she is, my queen.
I literally
slay them.
I literally teared up.
It's just like, I was like, she gave her everything to a boy who changed his mind.
Oh, that asshole who changed
and
his mind.
We both cried. I loved her.
That song.
My queen. Just, my queen.
Oh, she's such a good writer. She's Hey, everybody. Welcome back to another episode of Two Gay Mats. It's Matt Steele.
And it's Matt Palmer.
And here we are, two gays, talking about Taylor Swift again.
I mean,
she's just content, content, content.
I know. That's the thing. You can't get mad at her for not giving us enough because she's given us a lot. I feel like ever since she got on this new label in which she owns all of her rights and music to everything, mm-hmm. she just has a lot to say, a lot to put out in the world, and I appreciate
and
that.
And we're giving her money. We're literally just throwing our money at her. Netflix is. We are putting our money toward, well, you're putting your money towards Netflix,
I'm using it. I mean, I'm doing what everyone else does. I have someone's password for Netflix. People have my password for Hulu. It's fine.
And I go on to your thing.
Exactly.
For
yeah, so we're all thieves.
I'm paying nothing.
Yes, neither am I.
We stream Lover.
Yeah.
Did you buy Lover? Anyway. We love Taylor.
We love Taylor. She just released her new documentary, Miss Americana, which debuted at the Sundance Film Festival earlier this year. There were some bombshells. This was a look at Taylor Swift behind the curtain. Apparently, the director, Lana, whose last name I forget.
Lana
was following Taylor, it seems like, since the end of the Reputation tour. There's so much about the documentary that is incredible and really affecting, and by the end of it, I was very much like, God, I fucking love this girl.
Also, Lana Wilson.
Lana Wilson.
We love Lana Wilson.
If you have followed Taylor Swift as closely as we have followed her, you're not going to learn a lot of new things. Mm-hmm. The things that were new were kind of pre-released in the press, like the fact that she talks a bit about her eating disorder, the fact that they go into a bit more about the whole Kanye and like disappearing act of it all. And you know, obviously the big crux of the film is when she decides to come out as a Democrat.
You don't think about these musicians, especially in country music, like the fact that they kind of feel like they have to be completely silent just to appease all these people.
Right.
And just the scene of her just like hitting send on the tweet,
right.
How it's such a big deal. You're just like, oh my God, what am I doing?
I know.
And she just like hits send and like throws away her phone. Girl.
That's exactly what I did when I just posted like my pictures from the Britney in the Zone thing. I'm just like, I'm gonna post and throw it away.
Yeah, totally.
It's true. She was like, I have 120 million people following me. So what I say, I want to have been educated on everything that I feel before I go out and put my opinions out there. And I appreciate that. But I also feel like she definitely did come up in a post-Dixie Chicks world where it's like all of this can get taken away from you if you like are too far to the left. If you say things that are against the country music fan base, mm-hmm. you can become a pariah, people can dislike you. And she talks about even growing up, she always liked receiving little pats on the head, little like you're doing a good job. And she got, whether she got that from, you know, being a good student, being a good songwriter, having a billion adulating fans in the audience, or, you know, being as thin as she possibly could be in mm-hmm. during the 1989 era, that's what she gleaned her self-worth from. And
yes.
I think this film is about the undoing of that and
yes.
the fact that she's getting over that. And
oh, yes,
really
the fact that it all starts off with her, like, as a child, I was conditioned to always try to do the right thing, always do the right thing. I had no idea that she actually physically said, like, verbally said in interviews, like, well, I'm just a singer and no one wants to hear my opinions about politics.
Right.
I had no idea she actually said that. I thought it was kind of just like an unspoken thing.
She said it, and then also the fact that like David Letterman like high fives her after that.
Yeah.
Audiences erupt.
Different times.
And what were your favorite parts of the film?
Oh, that scene with the Grammy nominations. Because you never think about like, oh, I'm the biggest star in the world. It's nominations day. I didn't get the general one. And the fact that she's sitting there and she's just like, no, I just need to make a better record.
That scene honestly hurt my heart a bit because of her reaction. And we weren't obviously to the end of the film where she has been more enlightened and gone over everything and is like, I realize that people aren't always gonna like me kind of thing. But it's still the fact that, you know, Reputation's not my favorite. I think she should have made a better album, but I think I wanna make the best album I can make should not be connected to whether or not you get Grammy nominations or anything.
Of course,
because
yeah.
Mariah Carey put out an iconic album entitled Caution and got zero Grammy nominations, and never in a million years would I, or I hope her or anyone around her, sell her. You just need to make a better album next time.
Of course.
You've made the best album for Mariah Carey in 2018, and so Taylor Swift in 2020, make the best album for you, but like, I want her to feel freer, and that she did, and she got a couple nominations.
Well, what I find so interesting is that Reputation was an album all about, like, I don't care what anyone thinks now, I don't care, but then you see her Grammy nominations day. Caring.
From growing up in this industry for so long, it takes a long, long time to unlearn that.
Yeah, oh, you know? Absolutely. It's, and I feel like there's always still a part of you that, like, will care.
Right. My favorite scene in the whole thing, I think it was near the end, she was like, you know, I realize I'm turning 30, and for whatever reason, this industry just disposes of women once they hit 35, so I realize this is one of my last times that I'll be able to be hugely and giantly successful. They will allow me to be as successful as I am, so I'm really going to do all I can because I know that my time is running out.
And it's just, when she said that, I was just like, oh my god.
And because the thing is, she's absolutely fucking right. Mm-hmm. And it's devastating because of course she knows that she's very, you know, thoughtful. She has weighed all of the options. She's seen the people that have been in a position before, and she's seen what's happened to them. So she knows that, like, in 5 to 10 years, people are gonna care a lot less about her just because she's not young anymore. Mm-hmm. Like, it's like once a woman hits 30 to 33, like, it's like Katy Perry put out, if it was 7 years before and Katy Perry put out Never Really Over,
oh, it would have been a smash.
It would have been the biggest song of the year. It would be everywhere. It would be number one for weeks.
Yes.
And it peaked at 15.
Something interesting that Taylor also said that's really, I never really thought about that much, was when she's like, as a woman in the music industry, you constantly have to reinvent yourself. I was like, you know, that is something that male musicians don't worry about. Like, they don't think about what's this era going to be like? What are the visuals going to be like? Because I feel like it's only with women artists.
Absolutely.
It's just like, the era has this feel, and these are the pictures, and this is the sound and everything, and it you really have to play into that because you constantly have to change things up, and you have to work so much harder, whereas guys, it's just like, oh, I'm putting out another album, some new songs.
Yes, new songs.
I took a new album cover picture.
And that's why, you know, we don't review them.
Yes, they work harder and it's not fair, but like, also like, it does make it more fun.
It does make it more fun.
And it kind of like makes you feel like, oh, this is kind of amazing that they really put this much effort into their artistic work, which is why, like, women artists are just better. You can tell they work harder.
If I played you a Shawn Mendes song, you wouldn't know if it was from his current album, an album ago, or 2 albums ago. And if I played you a Taylor Swift song from Reputation, you would know the exact year, the month, you would know what was happening in her life.
Yes.
If I showed you a picture of an album cover, you would know exactly what year and era it was. You know, some male musicians do evolve. Like, I feel like Bruno Mars is an example of an artist who has evolved, but again, it's definitely more gradual. It's not like every single era had like a look and a sound and a feel. It was just like, okay, I've gone from being like a balladeer to doing kind of more up-tempo stuff, and now I'm doing like an 80s throwback thing, which again, he's doing more than most male artists do. Like, he is the biggest and best male artist I think that we have at the moment. But you think of like a Maroon 5, like Maroon 5's been making the same music since Payphone came out, and I love Payphone, and I love that first album of Overexposed, but everything's just been like diminishing returns version of like, okay, we've sold our soul to pop music, we work with Max Martin, Adam Levine's our front man, and there are also some other people here. That's been their aesthetic for 8 years, and they've gotten more radio hits than ever.
Yeah, and they're just like, yeah, but we love Maroon 5, but it's like, oh, Taylor, Reputation wasn't her best album, oh no, she's over.
And people got mad at Lover, because they were like, so parts of Lover just feel like they could, this is the first album she's not breaking new ground in her sound and like these songs, and it's like, but are the songs good?
Are the songs excellent? Yes, they are.
So what are we fighting about?
Yeah.
There are parts of like her story that I do wish that the documentary touched on a bit more. Like, I wish they touched on the fact that she, to her own admission on The Archer, she can be the archer and she can be the prey. I wish she had owned up a little bit more to the Kanye West part of it. Like, clearly.
Mm-hmm. Like, showed that part of the Grammys?
No, showed the part of the Grammys where she really digs in, like, digs her heels into, like, if any man ever tries to take credit for your success, say that you're the reason why you're famous. And it's like, I mean, what Kim did was annoying and, like, maybe it was unfair, but I feel like there has been zero accountability on her part, even though she was like, oh, you know what, I was unclear, I had heard parts of the song, and Yeah, I wound up changing my mind about it as I can do, and this is my feeling on it now.
Which is my prerogative.
Which is her prerogative, absolutely, but it was very much like, I wish the subject was maybe challenged a bit more. It was very much like, we love, we love, we love, and I do love her, but I wish she had been challenged a little bit, because she's not an innocent lamb all the time.
I wish more of the documentary was about the political stuff, because I found that really fascinating, even pre-midterm elections,
right.
Like the general elections, how she did just have that post being like, everyone vote, with like the blank ballot or whatever she posted and everything, it's kind of like, oh, damn. That whole conversation of just her arguing with her team, and she's just like, I want to do this, and her team's just like, we're scared, and she's just like, well, I'm doing it, so.
That scene was also so infuriating, because those men were very much like, well, what if I tell you the next time you go to a stadium, we're gonna just have the audience? What if I told you that? And like, you know, her dad being like, well, I am a person who bought armored cars, and I'm scared of her safety, so if you come out against Trump, people will come. And it's just like, just let her speak. At the end of the day, she's the head of the Taylor Swift Corporation. She steers the fucking ship. And if her mom's not worried, all you bitches will be fine.
I just find it so interesting how, like, she literally had a whole meeting about whether or not she should just post that she's endorsing this one Democrat.
Right.
And and the president's just, like, tweets, like, fart face, and tweets it. And no one's like, hey, Mr. President, like, let's have a meeting about what you tweet.
I mean, it's very clear that Taylor Swift runs her business much better than Donald Trump runs his.
When it was showing all the songwriting, which I loved all those videos. Yeah. Like, I always just like watching songwriters, like seeing how they do it, just because I don't know how they do it. I kind of thought that I was going to see her write Miss Americana and the Heartbreak Kids. And I was just like, I really want to see what went into writing that song. So when the scene came where she was writing a song, I was like, she's doing it. She's writing Miss Americana. That doesn't sound like Miss Americana. What the hell is this song?
If they'd shown her writing Cruel Summer, or they'd shown her writing Cornelia Street, or Death by a Thousand Cuts, I would have just melted in my chair.
But the fact that it was like, she wasn't even writing a song off of Lover, she was writing a song that she was promoting with the Netflix documentary, it was kind of just like, oh, what's this song?
I mean, she was writing The Man on screen, and that is also a song that's not my favorite, but the next single, so a good promotional move. And
of course.
That's the thing. Half of the movie is a promotional tool for the album and for Only the Young and all that.
Which, like, but good for you.
Of course. Like, why wouldn't it be?
Other awkward part of the documentary was when it showed Taylor reacting to that guy proposing to that girl. And Taylor was just like,
Oh, wow.
Oh, wow. Did you
know that was going to happen? Oh, wow. So I guess you're engaged. Wow.
I think it's like the girl didn't seem very surprised by it. She was kind of just like, it seemed like she was more concentrating on like Taylor's there than like her actual proposal. And so I think Taylor was kind of like working off of the other girl's energy. Right. And she was like, wow, are you excited?
It's different to do at a meet and greet when it's just kind of like the three of you in cameras taking a picture versus like when Mariah's brought some gays on stage to propose. And which was funny because someone called and watched What Happens Live and was like, you know what, I did that and I said I was proposing and it was a total lie. I just wanted to get up there and meet you. And Mariah was like, you know, can't hate it. but doing it in an audience, like everyone's cheering and applauding, like the emotion's hot higher than just like, there's just the three of us and I'm a stranger.
And also at a meet and greet, it's like rushed. Like they're just like, okay, rushed. We got a week. You have 30 seconds. Yes. You have 1 minute tops and everything. Whereas a show, you're just like,
I'm fine. Being famous must be weird sometimes.
I know. You're probably just like, congrats.
Yeah, like I don't need to be here for this.
I enjoyed the documentary.
I had
a good time. But honestly, I don't feel like I learned that many new things, but that's because I feel like I already know so much.
I think it was a nice little peek behind the curtain, but again, yes, I think Taylor Swift is always going to be, at this point in her life and career, more private than some people will be on screen.
It's crazy how through the years, how much I've just grown to just adore Taylor Swift's writing.
I mean, and I love that she knows it. She's like, everyone has something that sets them apart, and for me, it's my writing. It's my ability to tell a story. And that was so great when she was going into Lover with that attitude, and it was so clear because that album was so about the storytelling, and we loved it.
You all saw our Lover review.
You did!
And if you haven't, you can subscribe to our channel.
Taylor taught us about promotion, people.
Yes,
get ready.
Yes, for our channel. And also, we talk more in-depth about Miss Americana on our podcast, if you'd like to listen to our podcast.
It's more in-depth here than the podcast.
We talk about different things on our podcast. We touch on different points.
So, you can listen to our podcast. It's on Spotify or Apple Podcasts. You also can go to patreon.com/2gamematch for extra bonus content from us every single week.
Some Taylor content in there, too.
Yes.
Promotion.
Promotion. Follow us on Twitter and Instagram at Matt Palmer Music.
And it's Matt Steele.
And at 2gamematch for both both of us. Thank you to our iconic patron, Adam Parnell. Thank you guys so much for watching. We'll be back soon with another 2K Mats.
Bye.
Bye.